folks, how's it going? In this video, I'd like to talk to you about a technique called Gaussian elimination. It's named after Frederick Gauss, a prolific mathematician that came up with a way to solve systems of equations. Now, we've already learned how to solve a system like you see here, and that is what we call a 2x2 system. In other words, you have two variables and two equations. There's really several methods already. You could solve it by graphing, which is not the easiest way to do it, but possible. You can solve by substitution, or you can solve by elimination. And turns out this Gaussian elimination that I'm about to show you is really based on the elimination method for solving systems of equations, but we're going to use matrices. And the value in this is you can really solve any size system. So it doesn't have to be two variables and two equations. It could be five variables and five equations. So you could get these huge systems. Now we're going to do huge systems, but we're going to do bigger than this 2x2 we have going on here. The very first step, though, is writing this as what we call an augmented matrix for the system. So here's what you do. You make sure your X's and your Y's are lined up, just like using the elimination method, and your constants are on the other side. So this is required. The X, the Y, and if you have a Z, needs to be in the same order for every one of your equations, and the constant needs to be on the other side of the equal sign. So we have that in this situation. There's no rearranging that's needed. So what you do is you write yourself a matrix. There's the left bracket. And the coefficients, and you know what I mean by coefficients, these numbers in front, including the sign, are going to be your rows. Okay? So watch this. Here we go. So 4, you don't put the X, and -3 are coefficients in the first equation. And 3 and 2 are coefficients in the next equation. And then you draw this vertical bar to represent the equal sign. And 11 is on the first row because it goes with the first equation. And 4 is on the second row, and that goes with the second equation. Easy enough, right? So notice this is exactly what we have above, but with no variables at all. Alright, so let's take a look at this system. It's bigger, right? Notice you have an X, Y, and Z for all three equations. So what we call this is a 3x3 system of equations. There's three variables and three equations. Now remember I talked about how everything needs to line up? Notice it doesn't quite line up. But what you can do is think about this second one as 12X plus 3y. Notice there is no z. So you could put plus 0z equals 4. And then everything lines up nicely. I'm not going to rewrite the whole thing because I think you can see that. So here is our augmented matrix. On the first row, what are our coefficients? There's a 1 in front of the x. So 1, 5, and then 8 in front of the z. For our second, again, don't line up the wrong variables. 12 goes with X. So 12 is in the first row because that's our X's. 3 is in the second column. I say first row, first column. Let me be clear. Second column is a 3. The third column is our Z's, and that's 0. And if you need to do this at the top, just to remind you, there is X, Y, and Z, and then your constants are going to be here on the other side. Okay? Finally, the third equation, our coefficients are 3, 4, 9, and then we need that vertical bar to represent the equal sign, and then the first equation is equal to 19, the constant, 4 is the constant for the second equation, and -7 is the constant for the third equation. So X is in a column, Y is in a column, Z is in a column, equals is a vertical line. That vertical line really does need to be there. And then on the other side of the vertical line, we have our answers. Easy enough, right? Now here's an interesting problem, and this does show up in the homework that I've seen. Write the linear system for the augmented matrix. So instead of giving you the system and us giving them the matrix back, they're giving us the matrix, the augmented matrix, and we give them the system back. So remember the first column, those were our X's. The second column, those are our Y's. The third column are our Z's. And then, of course, you have equals, and then your constants or your numbers. So here we go. The first equation is 8x plus 29y plus, you could write 1z, but remember that 1 is really not required. When you multiply 1 times z, it's just z, and then equals 43. That's our first equation. Our next equation is negative x. You could say negative 1x, but that simplifies to negative x, plus 7y plus 5z is equal to 38. And then our third equation, watch that, 0x, and 0 times x is nothing, so I don't put anything there. Same thing with the 0y, so I have 3z only equals 10. And this would be the answer to our equation. Now, when you do these in the homework warning, what they do is they put a box here for the first equation, comma, a box here for the second equation, comma, a box here for the third one. So what goes in that first box is this whole thing, 8x plus 29y plus z equals 43. Next one would be negative x plus 7y plus 5z equals 38. You with me? And then finally, 3z is equal to 10. The box does get bigger. It didn't the way I drew it, but it does get bigger. So that's how they want those entered. All right, so this is the page of important stuff, okay? We know how to write an augmented matrix. That's easy. No big deal. Just make sure your X's and Y's and Z's are lined up. Everything is represented, so if it's missing a variable, that's a zero coefficient. Now we're going to perform what they call row operations to obtain row echelon form of a matrix. Big name, no big deal, though. So here's what I want you to notice about row echelon form. There are ones down the diagonal. You see that? So the top left should always be a one, and then the diagonal down should be a one. And it takes work to get there now. Below the ones are zeros. So everything below a one in a column should be a zero. So if you have a one top left, below that should be zeros. If you angle down and you have that one in the second row, second column, then below that should be a zero. If this were any bigger, this one would also have zeros below it. So the trick is, how do we get there? Okay, so we know now what row echelon form is. That's the goal, is to get your augmented matrix in row echelon form. Are you noticing something weird about this augmented matrix? It's not really an augmented matrix. They always do this in the definition, but really there's a vertical line here, and then there's a number here, and a number here, and a number here. That's really what the augmented matrix looks like. But the main part, your coefficients, again, should have ones down the diagonal and zeros below all the ones. Notice above the ones, that triangle, which happens to be a triangle in this case, those can be just numbers. Okay, so they don't have to be zeros or ones. That can be just plain old numbers. Now, next to purple are the things we are allowed to do. Okay, so to complete this task, we may interchange rows. So if I want to switch row 1 with row 2 because it will help me get that 1 in the top corner, I can do this. Okay, if I want to switch row 1 with row 3, I can do this. And then there's notation for us to do this. So the notation that you use is row, notice it says I and J, but you could say row 1, row 2. Because you always want to note how you got to where you're what you did. Okay, let me say it that way. So that's possible to interchange rows. Another thing possible is you can multiply a row by a constant. Okay, so if I wanted to multiply row 1 by 1/2, then I can do that. Or by negative 3, or by 14. I can multiply an entire row by a constant. You'll recall that from when we use the elimination method. We were allowed to multiply the first equation by negative 2, so it would add down and cancel with the second equation, right? That's this elimination process, and that's what Gaussian elimination is, okay? And the third thing we're allowed to do, and this is going to feel kind of new, but really it's just the elimination method, I'm able to add a product, which means multiply, of a row multiplied by a constant to another row. Okay, so I'm able to add rows together, even after you multiply one of them by a constant. And notice the notation for multiply a row is just C times that row. When you multiply a row and add it to another row, that's that R plus C times a row. And I know the notation as much to get used to as the process. But that's what we're allowed to do, again, three things: interchange rows, multiply a row by a constant, and add rows together. Okay? I oversimplified the third one because to me the third one already includes multiply a row by a constant, but we may do all that in one step. Now, the steps. Here are the steps, and we're going to try to apply these steps every time we do a problem, so I don't feel like it's something you're going to have to memorize. It's just a process. So step one, it says the first equation should have a leading coefficient of 1. So the first thing we're going to do is try to get a 1 in this top corner. So watch me erase. Step 1 is make this guy a 1. Now, look, I've already done this augmented matrix. But the first step is to make that a 1. Okay? Second step says use row operations to obtain zeros down the first column. So step 2 right here is going to get these zeros. We're going to do whatever we have to do to make those zeros. Step 3 right here is use row operations to attain a 1 in row 2, column 2. Then we get that 1. Step 4 is going to be to make zeros below that 1. Okay. Step 5, let me get into some more highlighter colors here. There we go. Step 5 right here, use row operations to obtain a 1 in row 3, column 3. We're going to make that a 1. And then step 6, you just continue this process until there's ones all the way down the diagonal and zeros underneath. Now, through step 5, finished the matrix we have sitting right here. But a bigger matrix would require you to do more rows and more columns that way. So again, get a 1 in top left, zeros below. 1 in the next place, zeros below. 1 in the next place, zeros below. So it's not as complicated as reading all this. So you're not going to memorize these steps. You're just going to go, okay, I want a 1 in top left, get zeros below. Okay, so let's try this. Here we go, a full problem. Now what I have in the blue box is those steps that I just went over, just in case we need to refer back to them, but I don't think you do. I think you've got this. Okay, so solve the given system by Gaussian elimination. Remember the very first step, and I don't mean this step one right here, is to write this as an augmented matrix. Okay, we have good practice with that. So on the first row is our first equation, 2x plus 1y equals 1, and remember you don't use any variables. So it's 2x plus 1y. We can go ahead and write the equals if you want, 1. Remember, a vertical line goes for the equals. Second equation, 4x plus 2y equals 6. So I need a 4 to represent my x, and then a 2 for the coefficient of y, and then 6 for my constant on the other side. So there is what we call our augmented matrix. Now, remember, our goal is to change this to row echelon form. So picture this. These twos, we want them to turn into ones, and then I need zeros below my ones, okay? This one, not an issue, okay? That could be anything when we finish, but these twos are going to eventually turn into ones, and this is going to need to be a zero. Now, the very first thing you have to do is make this two right here a one. How do you make a 2 a 1? Well, you multiply by a constant. So watch this. I'm going to say 1 half times row 1 replaces row 1. You catch that notation? Again, it takes practice. So I'm going to multiply the whole row 1 by 1 half. And you're thinking, oh my goodness, fractions. It's okay. You can do this, right? 1 half of 2 is 1. 1 half of 1 is 1 half. Don't you worry about that guy, he's fine. 1 half of this one is also 1 half. There's my vertical line, and I didn't do anything to row 2. So all I did was 1 half row 1 replaces row 1. I'm going to work across the page. I'm going to try to be efficient with my space, and we'll add another page if we need to. So look, I did my first step. Step 1 is to get a 1 right there. Step 2 is to make this a 0. Now think about when you use the elimination method. How did you make something a 0? Well, you would need to multiply this by negative 4. Now I'm not going to permanently leave it a negative 4. I'm going to multiply row 1 by negative 4 and add it to row 2. So negative 4 times row 1 plus row 2. And that's going to replace row 2. Don't believe me? Check this out. Okay, see if we can do this. So negative 4 times 1 is negative 4, plus 4 gives me 0. You with me? Okay, so again, negative 4 times this guy plus this guy gives me 0 there. Now, row 1 is not changing, so I might as well just recopy row 1. But row 2 is, because I'm doing negative 4 times row 1 plus row 2, and that replaces row 2. So negative 4 times 1 is negative 4, plus 4 is 0. That's what we need. That's the whole reason we made that decision. Now, every other calculation, or the other two calculations, are just because we have to do it for all of them. So help me out. Negative 4 times a half. What's a half of negative 4? Well, that's negative 2. Negative 2 plus 2 is 0. Okay. And then negative 4 times 1 half is negative 2. Negative 2 plus 6 is 4. And this is lousy, because I thought this would be a good problem to start with, and I'm just realizing that bad things have happened. You know why? Because this is a no-solution problem. Makes me mad. I got this out of the book as one of the very first examples, and it's a no-solution. They shouldn't give you a no-solution as one of the very first examples. I probably should have done it before I put it in the video, but how do I know this is a no-solution? Because here's what happens. When you get this in row echelon form, and by the way, step 7, I never read it to you, but it says if any rows contain all zeros, place them at the bottom. And there's all zeros. I cannot make this a 1 because it's a 0, but it's at the bottom. Now, if I go back and put this into system form, the top line says 1x plus 1 half y is equal to 1 half. That's fine. The bottom row says 0x plus 0y is equal to 4, which essentially says 0 equals 4. When in your mind is 0 equal 4? Never. So this is a contradiction. It's a no solution. And again, I apologize. I don't think I want to go back and redo the video, because you're going to see enough examples where we handle this. But I am frustrated that the first problem they gave out of the book for a you try problem was a no solution problem. But so be it, they happen, and now you see it. But we're going to do enough examples where you feel okay about this, okay? So let's build up some more skills. Okay, so let's take a look at this problem. It's bigger than the last problem, but it doesn't ask us to completely solve it. So even if it's a no-solution problem, it's not anything you need to worry about. It does ask us to put it in row echelon form, which is truly where all the work comes in. So first of all, we have to write it as an augmented matrix. No problem, right? X's are lined up, Y's and Z's. Just X, Y, Z in the first equation. X, Y, there's missing a Z in the second equation. That's okay. X, Y, Z in the third. They have to be in that order. So it's a 1 that goes with the X in the first equation, a negative 2 that goes with Y, a 3 that goes with Z, and on the other side of the equal sign is 9. Next equation is negative 1. Okay, a negative is not wanting to behave. Try that again. Negative 1. 3 for my y. Remember, there is no z. So it's 0 for z equals negative 4. And then my third equation, which I didn't give myself a lot of room for, so let's make that bigger, is 2 for the x, negative 5 for the y, 5 for the z, and 17 for the constant on the other side of the equal sign. So there's our augmented matrix. Now remember, we're trying to put this in row echelon form. So what's supposed to happen is write down the diagonal. I'm going to highlight it for you. Write down the diagonal. Those are supposed to be 1s. And everything below it, this negative 1 and 2 and negative 5, is supposed to be 0s. So that's our overall goal. The very first thing you have to do after writing the augmented matrix is get a 1 in the first spot. Look, there's already a 1. Phew! That's nice. Okay. So the very first step is done for row echelon form. So what I want to do now is get a 0 in this spot right here, or a 0 in this spot right here. Which one you do first actually does not matter. But I know you notice if I add row 1 and row 2 together, that's going to add to be 0. So let's do that. Okay? So what I'm going to do is put what we did above the matrix, it gives me more room. So I'm gonna do row 1 plus row 2 replaces row 2. You with me? And I'm gonna try to write a little smaller. So if I add row 1, and well, row 1 is not changing, so let's write it down. Okay, 1, negative 2, 3, and then across the line is 9. Row 2 is changing. So I'm doing row 1 plus row 2, and that's going to replace row 2. So if I add 1 and negative 1 together, that gives me 0. If I add negative 2 and 3 together, that gives me 1. If I add 3 and 0 together, that gives me 3. And if I add 9 and negative 4 together, that gives me 5. Row 3, he's staying just like he is for now. Okay, so we're doing good. We've got a 1 in the top left, right here. Now we've got a 0 below it. What do I have to do next? I have to get a 0 down here too. And remember, what order you get these zeros in doesn't actually matter. It doesn't. But you have to get a 1 here first before you make those zeros. Okay? And before you move on to the rest of this stuff. Because you're thinking, I got a 1 here, that's perfect. But it might change. Actually, it's not. But it could. Okay? So here's what I want to do. I want to get rid of this 2. How do I do that? The only way I can do that is add it to another row, or add it to the multiple of another row. Well, if this were a negative 2, right, I could add it to that and it would be 0. But I don't want to change this. So what I want to do is row operations, where I multiply negative 2 times row 1. And then I'm going to add that to row 3. And that's going to make a brand new row 3. So I'm not going to permanently multiply row 1 times negative 2. I'm doing it just for this row operation. Okay, so here we go. That means I'm not doing anything to row 1 as far as replacing it. I'm not. The only thing that's getting replaced is row 3. Row 2, I recopy it as well. And row 3 is the guy I'm working on, right? To replace row 3, I'm going to do negative 2 times row 1. So negative 2 times 1 is negative 2. And then I'm going to add that to 2, and that gives me 0. Okay, so let's try it again. It says negative 2 times the row 1 added to row 2. So that's negative 2 plus 2 is 0. Let's try it again for the second column, or the second position. So negative 2 times negative 2 is 4. 4 plus negative 5 is negative 1. Check it again. So negative 2 times row 1, negative 2 times negative 2 is 4. And then I add that to negative 5, which is negative 1. Now I'm at the third position. So negative 2 times 3 is negative 6. Negative 6 plus 5 is negative 1. Try it again. Negative 2 times 3 right here is negative 6. And then negative 6 plus 5 is negative 1. And then I have to go to the other side of the equals. Negative 2 times 9 is negative 18. Negative 18 plus 17 is negative 1. Okay? So how are we doing? Well, we've got a 1 in the first spot. 0 is below. That's the first two steps. We've got a 1 in the second diagonal position, and then we need a 0 below that. How do I do that? Well, listen, I don't want to work with row 1 anymore. You know why? Because I will lose this 0 right here if I do. If I add row 1 to anything down here, that's going to be gone. So now I can only work with row 2. You follow me? That's why doing it in this order matters. So I'm only working with row 2. But if I add row 2 to row 3, it's going to make that a 0. So if I add row 2 plus row 3, so row 2 plus row 3, and that's going to be my new row 3, then I'm going to be doing good, okay? So that means I'm not doing anything to row 1. 1, negative 2, 3, 9 is good. Not doing anything to row 2. I'm using it, but I'm not replacing it. So 0, 1, 3, 5. Here's where I'm doing my work. I'm going to add row 2 and row 3 together. And then it's going to replace row 3. So 0 plus 0 is 0. 1 plus negative 1 is 0. 3 plus negative 1 is 2. And 5 plus negative 1 is 4. How are we doing? Well, I've got a 1 in the first spot, 0 is below. 1 in the second position on the diagonal, 0 below. The next thing I have to do is make this guy a 1. How do I do that? Just multiply row 2 by 1/2. That's all you got to do, okay? Multiply it by 1/2. So if I multiply 1/2, I'm sorry, row 3. 1/2 row 3, and that's going to replace row 3. So to get a 1, you multiply. To get a 0, you multiply and you add. Have you caught on to that? Don't worry, we're going to do enough of these where you might be sick of it. So, row 1, 1, negative 2, 3, 9. Row 2, 0, 1, 3, 5. Row 3 is the guy we're working on. We're doing 1 half times everything in row 3, and I'm going to replace row 3 with that. So 1 half times this 0 right here is 0. 1 half times this 0 is 0. 1 half times this 2 is 1, and 1 half times this 4 is 2. And look, I lost my vertical bar. I need to put him back. There we go. Now, this is done. This is what we call row-echelon form. Okay? By the way, in the last video, we talked about operations on matrices, and we added them, and we subtracted them, and we multiplied them by a scalar. You can also multiply matrices together, but that did not show up in Math 112 curriculum, so I'm not showing you how to do it. But there's lots of things operations you can do with matrices. I'm only showing you the minimum to get you through this course and to help you when you take a calculus class, or if you ever heard linear algebra, that's exactly what this is, okay? Okay, now we've practiced row echelon form. We will practice it again, don't worry, but I'm gonna leave it for just a minute because I want to show you the last step in this process. And that problem that we did two problems ago, that was a no solution, and I was irritated because it was a no solution, but I'm keeping it in the video anyway. That was a complete problem. This is the last step. What do you do to the problem to solve it if it's in row echelon form? First of all, do you agree this is in row echelon form? Let's take a look at it. Do I have ones down the diagonal? Sure do. Okay. Do I have zeros below all the ones? I do, don't I? So that means, because the zeros make a triangle, I think that's really cool. And then ones down the diagonal. So as long as I have that, that's what we call row echelon form. Well, y'all, when it's in row echelon form, you're ready to solve. And it's easy. This is the easy part. I know the row operations is the hardest part. So watch this. I'm going to write my top equation that says 1x plus 0y plus 0z is equal to 31. Are you thinking, do I have to write all those zeros? You don't. We'll talk about it in a minute. Next line says 0x plus 1y plus 1z is equal to 45. The third row says 0x plus 0y plus 1z is equal to 87. So let's turn this into something a little more simplified. Like anything with a 0 times it, that's just 0. And 1 times something is just that thing. So this really says x is equal to 31. Now, you don't always have zeros for these two. So that's kind of fortuitous that we already know what x is. The second row says 0x, so I'm not going to write that. 1y, so I have y plus z is equal to 45. We're not there yet as far as that goes. But the last line, that's where your information is going to come from every time. That last line should have, because this is a 0, this is a 0, and the very last variable is going to be the one that's a 1, and your bottom row is going to say 1z equals 87, or z equals 87. And this is the one that's going to be solved for. So that's why, if you don't mind me jumping back, the problem that we solved, that we got a no solution and I got frustrated, look at this. It's because this 0 over here should have been a 1, and then we would have, like, say 1 equals 4. Then y equals 4. 1y equals 4. But because there's a 0 there, and anytime you have a row of zeros at the bottom, you either have a no solution or infinitely many solutions, we'll get there. Then this one went weird on us. But this one did not go weird. Okay, so we reduced this guy. And we got what we needed. This right here, z equals 87. And then what you do is called back substitution. I need to get my ink back. So the last step to solve is called back substitution. And I know you're already used to substituting a lot when you solve a system. So you take that bottom row information, z equals 87, and you substitute it into the row above. So I know that y plus z is 87 is equal to 45, and I solve for y, and 45 minus 87, you know, you just subtract 87 from both sides, so 45 minus 87 is equal to negative 42. And then you would take that information and then plug that into the top one. But again, we already have x equals 31, so we don't have any more back substitution to do. Now, how do you write your answer? It's x, then y, then z. That's called an ordered triple, okay? So x is first, it's 31, y is next, negative 42, and z is last, 87. And close out the parentheses. And that's your answer, and that's how you do the last step of Gaussian elimination. So as you can imagine, whereas the last video and sections that we worked on was the easiest thing you do in this course, I won't call this the hardest, but it can make for some really big problems. Math problems, not problems. All right, so here's another one that says solve the system of equations using Gaussian elimination. So it's augmented matrix already set up. Is this row echelon form? Well, no, not quite, right? We don't have ones down the diagonal. Now, it's nice we have zeros below the diagonal, so that could help out, but we don't have ones down the diagonal. How do we get there? Okay, well, remember, step one is to get a one right here in the top left. We got that. Step two is to get zeros below. We have that too. This is nice. So the next thing would be to make this guy right here a one. So let's do that. To make ones, you multiply by the reciprocal. To make zeros, you have to multiply and add. To make ones, all you do is multiply by the reciprocal. The reciprocal of what? Of 5, right? So I'm going to multiply 1/5 times row 2, and that's going to replace row 2. In other words, I'm just going to multiply row 2 by 1/5. That's the reciprocal of 5. So row 1 doesn't change at all. It's 1, 2, 3. Don't forget the vertical line, 4. Row 2, now 1/5 of 0 is 0, 1/5 of 5 is 1. Now 1/5 times 6 is 6/5. It's not pretty, but it's right. 1/5 times 7 is 7/5, okay? And then my third row is recopy 0, 0, 8, 9. That's a 9. There we go. Now I'm looking at this matrix now, and I'm almost in row echelon form. Again, to repeat, you got to have a 1 in the top left, zeros below. Then the next step, step 3, you have to have 1 in position column row 2, column 2, and zeros below. We got that. The third thing is this has to be a 1. How do you make 1s? By multiplying by the reciprocal. So to make this A to 1, I multiply by 1/8. So I say 1/8 times row 3 is going to replace row 3. All right, so all I'm doing is changing row 3, which means row 1 stays exactly as is. Row 2 stays exactly as is. Row 3, we multiply by 1/8. So 0 times 1/8 is 0. 0 times 1/8 is 0. 8 times 1/8 is 1. And 9 times 1/8 is 9/8. Okay, notice we are in what we call row echelon form now. We've got ones down the diagonal, and we got that triangle of zeros underneath. So we're good, which means now it's time for back substitution. So we'll change colors to show you we're moving on. So the top row says x, that's 1x, right, plus 2y plus 3z is equal to 4. Row 2 says 0x plus 1y plus 6/5 z is equal to 7/5. Row 3 says 0x, so I don't write it, plus 0y, so I don't write it, plus 1z is equal to 9/8. Now look at there. Z is solved. My next step is back substitution. So I go back up an equation and plug in 9/8 for z. So now I have 1 plus 6 fifths times 9 eighths equals 7 fifths. Now I just got some algebra work to do. Y plus, now I can reduce some of this, like this, these both divide by 2, right? So that's going to be 3, and that's going to be 4. 3 times 9 is 27 twentieths equals 7 fifths. What am I going to do now? I'm going to subtract 27 twentieths from 7 fifths. So 7 fifths minus 27 twentieths. Now, if you have a fraction button on your calculator, now, folks, is the time to use it. I'm going to multiply this by 4 over 4 to find a common denominator. And now I have y is equal to, that's 28 twentieths minus 27 twentieths, which is 1 twentieth. So now I know that y is equal to 1 over 20. Now I gotta find z. Okay? That means, not z, I'm sorry, you have z, x. So now I go back to the top equation. So you work yourself backwards. And for z, apologize, I keep calling that z. It's not, it's x that we need. I need to use this top equation. Now, if you don't mind, for space purposes, I'm going to get rid of this calculation that we have below. Over here to the right, I'm going to write what the conclusion was z is equal to 9 eighths, okay? And over here we have y is equal to 1 over 20. So I don't need these two lines anymore, so I'm going to get rid of them. Again, my page needs to be a little bigger, or I need to write smaller, but I can't seem to write smaller with this pen. So here we go. I'm going to use my top equation. That says, I'm going to change colors so you follow, x plus 2 times y, which remember is 1 over 20, plus 3 times z, which is 9 eighths, is equal to 4. Okay? Now, I need to add all this together again. Calculator button, fraction button is your friend, but I'm not going to use that. So x is, this 2 and this 20 leave me a 1 tenth plus 27 eighths is equal to 4. Remember, I'm trying to solve for x, so I need to add these two fractions together. My common denominator there is, what, 40? So the tenth I'm going to multiply by 4 over 4. The eighth I'm going to multiply by 5 over 5. And I'm going to do some of this in my head, so it's going to give me x plus, this is 4 fortieths plus 27 times 5. And use my calculator for that, is 135. So scribble up here, that's 135. So 4 plus 135 is 139 over 40, and that equals 4. Finally, I subtract 4 minus 139 over 40, and that's going to give me my x value. So I just subtracted that dude to the other side. Again, a fraction button on your calculator would make this far less miserable for you and me. So multiply by 10 over, no, you multiply by 40 over 40. So that's 160 minus 139 over 40. So 160 minus 139 should be 21, but to make myself feel better, I'm going to type it in. Yep, 21. And so that does not reduce, so x is equal to 21 over 40. Now, how do you type that in? Again, that is an ordered triple. I'm going to put it right over here, y'all, the only space I have, in black so you can see it. Here we go. My ordered triple, x is 21 over 40, y, where are you, is 1 over 20, and z is 9 eighths. Now, I hope for you that they don't all turn out like fractions like this, but that's pretty common. So, how could you check this? And the check could be as brutal as the work in the first place, but you would have to plug 21 over 40, 1 over 20, and 9 over 8 into your original equation for all three equations and make sure that's true. So, there's no space for that, but that is something you really should do. You should check it. And again, if you have a fraction button on your calculator, no big deal. because you have even numbers you're dividing by here, you could also change those to decimals without any grief as well. Okay, now, this says solve a system using Gaussian elimination. This is the last problem I'm going to do in this video, and then I'm going to come back with a part two, because this is getting pretty drawn out, where we work problems just all the way through. Okay, so this is already, is it an augmented matrix? I mean, no, it's not, right? Because you're supposed to get a 1 in the top left. We've got that, so we've got a good start, but we don't have a 0 below it, right? We've got a 1 below it. That's not what we want. So what are we going to do to fix this? Well, remember what? The top row is good. We're trying to make this a 0. To make zeros, you multiply and add. Write that down somewhere. To make zeros, you multiply and add. Sometimes you can just add if these are already opposite signs, but they're not. So I have to multiply negative 1 times row 1, add that to row 2, and that's going to replace row 2. That's what we're going to do. So here we go. Top row, not changing. That's 1, 0, and on the other side, a 1. I'm going to make that look not like a 10. There we go. Now, so let's do this. Negative 1 times row 1. So negative 1 times 1 is negative 1, plus 1 is 0. Negative 1 times 0 plus 0 is 0. Negative 1 times 1 is negative 1, plus 2 is 1. Now, believe it or not, this is in row echelon form. I know what you're thinking. You've got the 1 and you got the 0. That part's all good. But this needs to be a 1. But folks, there's no way you can turn a 0 into a 1. You can't do it. And remember, step 7 says you have to have your 0 rows on the bottom. So that's what we have. Now, what this says is that 0x plus 0y is equal to 1. Now, we all know that 0x plus 0y is just saying 0 equals 1. And what do we know about that? It's no solution. Now, y'all, this one I knew was no solution. That was the whole point that I picked this problem out. The other one I didn't expect to be no solution, but there you go. And we're going to do enough of these where that's okay anyway. But how do you know a no solution? When you have a row of zeros at the bottom equal to a number, okay? That's impossible. You can't have a row of zeros over here equal to a non-zero number over here. Now, if this were 0, that would be infinitely many solutions, okay? So here's, go ahead and write this down somewhere. If your bottom rows are 0, 0, and then you have a number that's not 0, that's a no solution. On the other hand, and we will see one of these, okay, if you have 0, 0, and over here another 0, that's infinitely many solutions. Okay, so I'm going to stop this video now, just to give you a break, and then we'll come back and do part two, where we work these problems all the way through.